Hey, brothers and sisters, this is your favorite brother from another mother coming to you. It is about 1 o'clock in the morning here on the 25th of December after New Year's Christmas Eve. Anyway, I've been trying to get my computer working here. I've been having issues with drivers or some update, I guess. Audio issues with everything on my computer. Anyhow, brothers and sisters, praise the living God. The Lord had spoken to me. I was praying with a sister the other day on Facebook, and the Lord just spoke to me for having her and myself also, and then all of you, that we would, this week, we would make a list of, and write it down. The Lord even gave me a Bible verse for that. You know, it's from the Old Testament. That is from Habakkuk 2:2, which is the Lord told the prophet Habakkuk, you know, write the thing down, you know, so that all can see. So that's the verse that the Lord spoke to me. And the Lord had did that to me before. He'd spoken to me before, maybe 2007 or 2008. One time when I first came to the Philippines. Anyway, so I did it. Made a list. And the Lord told me to keep, you know, to pray over that and believe and then see those things fulfilled that the Lord would do. So as I was thinking about it, this sister, she has a channel. And she just made a, you know, I don't have hardly anybody that made a video on, that put on my channel. I don't know that I've ever had. I've had guests on, but anyway, this sister, she has a channel, and I'm going to get her to put her link down here in the comment sections, and she does videos about makeup and stuff, so of course, I don't watch those, but some of you guys are probably be interested in those things, but she's been a Christian for a long, long time, since she was a kid, so she's a mature Christian, and you know, so I'm sure she can be a blessing to some of you guys to hear things from her, and I can't remember exactly how she calls her channel. Something about milk. It'll be in the comments. But anyway, she's going to make a video about it too. But what I want to do is this week, now today, I want to give you an outline for the things to talk about. And then the vision. And then next week, we'll do it. We'll do a prayer together over our visions. And it will be for the year 2018. Old man's calendar. There's always someone that says, well, you know, that well, the calendar that God gave the Israelites, you know, we know it starts at the Yom Teruah, which of course people call it the Feast of Trumpets, Rosh Hashanah, but the real name is, you know, Yom Teruah, you know, the day of shouting. But anyhow, on the calendar that's accepted by the world, it begins January 1st, 2018. So we'll make a list, brothers and sisters, of all the things that, so the categories are like spiritual things, like, you want to be baptized in the Holy Spirit. You have a goal for the year 2018 to be baptized in the Holy Spirit. And I've made videos about that. And, you know, like in the book of Acts, chapter 2 and chapter 19, chapter 8, chapter 11, several other places in there we see where people are baptized in the Holy Spirit. And they had this initial evidence of speaking in tongues, but not always having the gift of tongues. Afterwards, there's something called praying in the Spirit. I've made many videos to explain the different gifts of the Spirit. You search my channel, you'll see those, and I'm sure the Lord will lead me to make more videos about the gifts of the Holy Spirit. But anyhow, as an example, you may say, oh, I want to start praying an hour every day, you know, for the, you know, in 2018. You're going to have your list, you're going to keep looking at it every day. You're going to look over that list in the morning. Or it could be, here's a great one, to read the Bible within a year. You know, you can read the New Testament within a month. The Old Testament's a lot longer. And I would say that it takes if you read three chapters a day, every day, you can read the Bible in a year. And you can go online and look for, you know, calendars, you know, a schedule, you know, keep you on schedule how many chapters you should read. Another thing is, you know, when you get into some of those chapters, like the dimensions of the ark, or the dimensions of the tabernacle in the wilderness and all that, you know, some of those things you can skip through unless you see a video, a visual, you know, showing that thing in front of you. When you listen to those numbers and, you know, and cubits and all that stuff, you know, unless you have a great imagination or you have, you know, engineering, you know, skills and blueprint reading, you don't sit there and read all those exact figures. So when you start cutting out those things and skipping over those things, it's just reading those numbers, those measurements and stuff. It's actually a whole lot less. There's many, many chapters that are things like that, like the numbers of each tribe in the book of Numbers. But there are lots of great things in the book of Numbers, but a lot of it is Numbers, the book of Numbers. And it's like the count of how many people in each tribe and each clan and every family and all this. You can skip through those things as an example. You can, you know, and then another thing you can do, listen to the Bible on audio on your way and to and from work. You have an MP3 player, through your car stereo, or if you have a CD player, whatever, you can listen to the Bible while you're driving and say, hey, I'm going to read the whole Bible in a year. That's a great spiritual goal. I'm going to fast this year. You know, I want to fast one day a month or whatever. As an example, 3 days a month, whatever. You know, you set a goal. So then the natural goals for yourself and then your family. So a natural goal for you could be stop smoking. You know, stop watching television. Whatever, as an example, like that. Those are also part of your sanctification. Negative sanctification, positive sanctification. Negative sanctification is, I'm going to stop smoking. I'm moving away from something that's bad for me. Positive sanctification, I want to pray an hour a day. I want to fast, like those things I mentioned. Those are positive sanctification, moving toward the Lord. The negative sanctification is moving away from sin, separating yourself from the things of the world. Television, as I mentioned. Gluttony, whatever, eating a bag of Oreos every day. You know, I'm gonna limit it to just half a bag every day. As an example, or whatever. You know, then there's the for your like your family. You know, you say, I commit that I want to spend 30 minutes a day with my children, for men especially, or if you work, I want to spend 30 minutes a day with each kid, and you know, if you got more than one child, talk to them about the Bible or whatever. You know, have a, you know, we're gonna commit that our family's gonna have a daily devotional. It's a great one right there. You know, then there's personal goals, you know, for your family. You know, we need to buy a house. We need a new car. Those are also things that we can pray for and believe for that God will provide because we need it. It's not like, oh, you know, the prosperity thing where, you know, I need a gold-plated Cadillac, you know. No, I mean, we need transportation, you know, because when I first started in the ministry, I had this old raggedy car in the States I was driving around, and it kept breaking down, you know, and I had to get my dad to come get me. Luckily, I just started having a cell phone at that time, and actually, I didn't get my first cell phone until 2003. And so at first, yeah, they have roadside assistance. And the guy, you know, I got it. He let me use his phone. And he's like, what, you don't have a cell phone? No, that's why I got one. But anyway, you know, my dad was telling me, he's like, look, you keep paying to fix this car. You know, it's costing more than getting a new one. But what I did is I got a car that was 1 year old and it was half the original price. It was, you know, it was originally $20,000. I got it for like $9,500, a 1 year old car with 20,000 miles on it. It was a 1999 Pontiac Grand Am. That was a nice car. So anyhow, you need something that's reliable. So you can say, yeah, well, you know, I'm so pious, you know, and I'm such a Christian, I need to get the cheapest car I can. That's what I did. It's a Ford Escort. It's like a 1990 Ford Escort or 80-something maybe. It was a piece of junk. And trying to, you know, but it wasn't very safe and, you know, it broke down all the time. And so you end up spending more and you can't, you know, like for me, I was going to, as a matter of fact, I used it to go do the ministry. So I can't go tell somebody I'm going to come pray with them at the hospital, and then I don't show up because my car broke down. I mean, you know, people start thinking, well, you know, you're not reliable. Maybe you're lying. Maybe something else is going on. I mean, you got to be professional too. And even going to work, et cetera. You keep missing work, you get fired, whatever. So you've got to have reliable, good transportation. It's not being greedy to say, hey, I need a car that's only a couple years old. I don't need a 20-year-old clunker and, oh, that makes me pious. I dealt with people like that before too. You know, one time there was somebody you know, they had a full-size van that was like 40 years old. It's like a 1970 Chevrolet van. And they were like, I'm going to give it to you, but they wanted me to fly out west to a West Coast state. I won't say which one. And then drive. Then they live like 4 hours from the main city in that state. And then drive 4 hours on it. Ride a Greyhound bus 4 hours. They're going to give me this 1970 van that had like 300,000 miles on it. And then, you know, some people might say, well, that's awesome. Yeah, but by the time flying out there, and then driving it back, if it made it, would be more than the value of the vehicle. You know, it costs like $1,000 to do that. You know, one-way ticket and then drive it and all that. And then it's 40 years old. I mean, you got to, you know, you also, you know, can't, you know, be something, you know, we have to be careful that we're not, you know, being pious in our flesh. I mean, you got to have something that's going to go. You got to have something that's reliable. You got to have good tires and all that stuff. It's not being, you know, closer to the Lord to risk, you know, killing yourself, killing other people, because the tires are worn out, the brakes are bad, you know, it's a piece of junk. You know, so we also have to use, you know, the Lord wants us to have, you know, something that's good enough to get where we got to go. But it doesn't have to be overly fancy. Anyway, brothers and sisters, those are some of the examples. I'll go ahead and cut it off. Like I said, I'm starting to get woke up now. We've had our, every day they do stuff here. We had my wife's family over. We had a big meal. And I talked to them about, you know, about the real meaning of Christmas and all that. Of course, they're almost, I think they are 100% Christian. So, you know, my wife's family. So, you know, no evangelism really going on in that end of it. But praise the Lord. And been having all these issues with my computer, I ask you, brothers and sisters, to pray. I got to figure out. I think I did an update, and then there's something that got corrupted there with my stupid Microsoft store, maybe. Every time I try to use it, something else is wrong. Get that going, and then it'll be something else. So I don't know what's going on. But anyway, brothers and sisters, God bless you. The sister, I don't know if she's going to say, if she said what her name was or not. I don't know if she was saying her name in her videos or not. I can't remember. But anyway, she'll have a link below. And to her, she's making a video. I think she's going to discuss what's actually on her list. Now, I will discuss what's on my list next week. So make your list. That's the challenge for this week. Make your list. We're going to write it down, make it plain, Habakkuk 2:2. Next week, we'll review it, pray together for it on New Year's Eve. It'll be New Year's Eve here, night here, afternoon there. And we'll pray, you know, for the Lord will answer what's on your vision, your list for next year. You know, and if you pray as you're making your list, I mean, that's the whole thing. The Bible says if a man's ways are pleasing to God, he will give him the desires of his heart. But, you know, I always say I read that in reverse. It's not that, you know, I desire a gold-plated Cadillac, so God's going to give me one. I believe that God will give me the desire for the things that he wants me to have. You know, God's plan is for me to have a, you know, because I don't have a home in the States. And I sold my house and moved to the Philippines in 2007. So kind of, you know, homeless in a way. Of course, we got a place here now since 2014. Kind of more of a permanent place here. But, you know, it's like my desire, and I believe it's from the Lord, that we'll have a, you know, more stable address in the States. And maybe to be pastor in the church, or, you know, I would plan on, my desire is to go do revivals all over the United States and churches in the United States and even in the world, whatever. As the Lord has spoken to me about going to Germany, to Hamburg, Germany, Hanover, Germany, specifically. So it's up to the Lord to go do revivals. So, you know, the Lord had given me the desire to have that as part of my vision. You know, I'm going to be going to New Zealand February 2019 for the whole month, and I'll be doing preaching all over New Zealand. And we're working on the schedule right now. So praise the Lord for that. So, you know, those are the things that's going to be on my list because, you know, I'm in the ministry. But you should, like I said, you have things to do with the Lord, spiritual, natural things. Like you say, you need a new car. Maybe your car keeps breaking down. You pray God to make a way. You need a better job. You know, you need to get a house or whatever, you know, those things too. And then for your family, you pray that I need to lose weight. I'm overweight. I got high blood pressure, whatever. Praying for God to heal me. Praying for God to use me in the gift of healing. Any of those things. It's all over the place. Whatever. Those things, and set those as goals, and we're going to pray, and you're going to keep praying over and look at that list every day, you know, and God will give you the wisdom to go step by step. The thing about it is, brothers and sisters, as an example, let's just say you got emphysema and you smoke, or you've got asthma and you smoke, and you say, God, heal me of asthma. Well, it would be common sense that the Lord would want you to quit smoking, so you would get, you know, that may be the reason why you have asthma, as an example. Just one. Or you're 20 pounds overweight. Well, you know, you need the Lord to give you the strength and, you know, heal you of your desire to eat too much. And then maybe you have something else going on. God will give you the wisdom. Hey, you need to use a little apple cider vinegar every day. You know, it gets kind of comes into your mind, hey, from the Lord that, hey, I need to take a tablespoon of apple cider vinegar. As an example, that could be, you know, a cure for whatever your underlying problem is. As an example. So God will give you step-by-step wisdom. The Bible says in James Chapter 1, he who lacks wisdom, let him ask, and God loves to give it liberally, you know, and then don't be double-minded. It talks about being double-minded. You know, God gives you wisdom, and you still do your own thing. So, but God will give you step-by-step wisdom. Everything doesn't have to be a miracle. Like, you know, in other words, like if I'm sick and I've got high blood pressure, and then, you know, I ask God to heal me high blood pressure, which he could, but it could also be I need to stop eating, you know, bacon every day, or whatever it is. I start eating a handful of salt every day, or whatever's causing my high blood pressure. You know, maybe I need to, you know, make changes and it will be healed. You know, I don't need a miracle. I need to do prevention. You know, as they say, a pound of prevention is worth an ounce of cure. Or an ounce of prevention is worth a pound of cure. You know what I mean, brothers and sisters. I sound like W. Bush, don't I? That's why I use the Google also. Anyway, brothers and sisters, God bless. Have a Merry Christmas. You know, I'm just getting started. Hallelujah. Praise God. I've been wanting to make videos. I've been so busy with the ministry, brothers and sisters, with the orphanages and the feeding programs. Been all over the place. Running around like a chicken with your head cut off, as they say. Anyway, the Lord led me to start a GoFundMe, and I've had people that suggested that for years, since the first time we had trouble with PayPal, which is in 2013, maybe. People's been telling me, do GoFundMe, and then when I first researched it, they have like a 5% charge. I was like, no, I'm not going to do it, but this time, I just was led by the Lord to do it, and then when the Lord was leading me, then there was that sister who I made a video of, the sister that was in the accident, and by the way, I'll be Skyping with her on the 26th or the 27th. I've been talking to them, and they sent me some pictures of their medical paperwork and stuff. She is a legitimate person. She's been watching me for years. So I don't know her greatly, but I know of her, know her as one of my regular viewers. Anyway, and I'll be Skyping with her to be healed. So I guess you guys pray for her, and I'll have all that information of her stuff below the video too. Sister Gustafson, you know, it's so funny because this is how funny things are. She was airlifted to Erlanger Hospital in Chattanooga. Well, I used to live in a town in Germany when I was in the army called Erlangen, but I lived on a street called Gustavstrasse. How about that? Her name is Gustafson, and then she was airlifted to this Erlanger Hospital in Chattanooga. How about that? Isn't that wild? That's just one of those things that's just like makes you say, But anyhow, it's just a cool little thing. So I started the GoFundMe, and I have the link below here, and it's awesome. They stopped charging the 5% surcharge, so that's awesome. And they just did that November the 30th. So starting December 1st, there's no more 5%. And I didn't know that until after I started the GoFundMe, but the Lord was leading me, make the GoFundMe. And then, because I had a dozen people recommend it, and then this sister said she had made a GoFundMe, she was injured. And so that's the time it really, it's like a confirmation from the Lord, I need to do it. So I made it. Somebody asked me about the 5%. I did a search because I thought it still was 5%. I double checked and they just stopped it. So as of December 1st, there's no more 5% surcharge. So praise God. Perfect. They rely on tips, people to donate to them, GoFundMe.com. So anyway, brothers and sisters, I'm excited about that because a lot of people gave through PayPal. They don't do checks and money orders and things like that. A lot of you guys send me, especially older people, the younger people are, the more electronically they live. And so there are people that have probably never even written a check in their life. It's, hard to believe for you guys who are older, but I would say probably almost all the people under 30 never written a check in their life. Or maybe 25, you do it online or whatever. So PayPal, et cetera, But anyway, so praise the Lord for all those things, brothers and sisters. I'm excited. I'm happy at what God's doing with the orphanages and the feeding programs, and we can get all of our buildings up to standard, and get them all fixed up nicely and repaired, all the damages. We need to get some motorcycles. We need to get another vehicle for the ministry, for all the work that we do. So I praise the Lord. I already know that God's going to make a way. And then this GoFundMe is just a huge relief compared to, we've been struggling because of the lack of PayPal. So praise the Lord, brothers and sisters. Praise the Lord. This is even easier than PayPal. Even easier, much easier than even PayPal. PayPal has got lots of rules to get set up, and this is real easy. So anyway, brothers and sisters, God bless you all. I know I said that a few times. I'm so excited about the Lord. I wanted to preach. I've been wanting to make videos preaching. I'm so full of the Word of God to preach, and I'm going to come on here and make videos. But I want to get this uploaded and try to figure out what's wrong with the audio on my computer, etc. So God bless you all. Love you all. God bless. And I said... just pray for Sister Gustafson, last name. And her husband's name is Neil. And I'll be talking with him, too. I've been emailing with him because she has a traumatic brain injury. So anyway, brothers and sisters, God bless you all. Love you all. Merry Christmas to those of you who celebrate the virgin birth of the Lord Jesus Christ, even though we don't know what day it is. We have no idea. There's people saying, made videos saying certain dates, September the 11th. And all this, that's just a great speculation. But the Bible doesn't say what day Jesus was born. It doesn't matter. If the Lord wanted us to know what day it was, He would say. The only thing I do is I accentuate the positive and eliminate the negative. And don't mess with Mr. In-Between. I tell people that's about the virgin birth of Jesus, angels we have heard on high, sweetly singing lullabies. Gloria in excelsis Deo. Gloria in excelsis Deo is Latin for glory to God in the highest. Hallelujah. That's what the angels said to the three shepherds abiding in the field. Glory to God in the highest. Peace on earth and goodwill toward all men. Hallelujah. For unto us this day a Savior is born in the city of David. That's Bethlehem. Hallelujah. Christ the Lord. Hallelujah. Our Lord Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Bless His name. Blessed be the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. For He is the King of kings and the Lord of lords. God is good. I'm getting started. All the time. He put a song of praise in this heart of mine. God is good. God is good all the time. Hallelujah. Wicked sinners, we were so unworthy, but for us he chose to die. He filled us with his Holy Spirit, so we could stand and testify that his love is everlasting, and of his mercy there shall be no end. God is good. God is good all the time. Hallelujah. Praise God. Hallelujah. I'm just getting started, brothers and sisters. I might make a separate video. I'm getting all fired up now. You know, I'm going to have to get me some coffee so I can really do like Begley. Get all jacked up on 100 cups of Starbucks and go for it. Hallelujah. You know, that reminds me. There's people, of course, I'm in the Philippines. But you know, people send Begley coffee all the time. That's how he's able to stay all fired up and wired up all the time. You know, brothers and sisters, somebody could send me some coffee. I'm just teasing. It's a long way. It's a long way to the Philippines, brothers and sisters, and it's not an easy thing to send stuff here. We do have, that reminds me, Sister Pearly, I always keep forgetting. Dear Sister Pearly, who is a Filipino but is an American citizen now, her and her family, and I did a video with her. I met her there. We went to her house, and we went to eat Filipino food there in Chicago. My wife, you know, of course, is Filipino, so they enjoyed it. They loved it. We ate Filipino food. I made a video with her. Sister Pearly, you know, being a Filipino, she has connections, or Filipina to be exact. It's A if you're a female and O if it's a man. She's connected to people that can send these big boxes, and they go on a ship. It takes like 2 months to get here, but it's very cheap. I think the regular price is like $120, but you can get a missionary price. Maybe it's $80 or $90 per box. I want to say, just say it's less than $90 a box. Maybe $88, whatever. So we've been doing it for several years. People send stuff to Sister Pearly. Her information is below the video, too, in the See More. Click on that. You'll see it, and it's also on the Facebook group, the Joshua's Ministry Facebook group. I post pictures and videos all the time of the orphans and the feeding programs we do. Anyway, at the top up there, there's information about the ministry, and then there's also Sister Pearly's Facebook account and her email address and everything and her mailing address. So people send stuff to her, summer clothes, toothbrushes, things that won't go bad on the boat. So you've got things that are not perishable, you know, and it doesn't matter about the weight. From her end, the box weight doesn't matter. It's the size. You know, it's a huge box, too. It's probably 1 yard tall by half a yard wide, square, you know, so it's pretty big. It's like this tall, and it holds a lot. Anyway, so like I said, weight is not a problem. It's just you don't want to send something that would go bad quickly. So, I mean, but you could send, you know, something. Of course, it would be not necessary, but like a can of spam as an example. It would come here, but you can get spam here. So we don't need any spam in the Philippines. Filipinos love spam because of World War II and the Americans being here. And spam is a delicacy here in the Philippines. And my son loves to eat spam and rice. But anyhow, things like the children's shoes, any size, because we're feeding 1,000 street kids. If somebody will be able to wear the shoes, no matter what. Girls, boys, it doesn't matter. And then of course, I can get these flip-flops real cheap here, so no need to really send those. Some shoes, tennis shoes, dress shoes for kids, boys, girls, etc. Summer clothes particularly, we can't really use a whole lot of winter clothes, but you could be a long-sleeve shirt, you know, long-sleeve pants, but not like a coat and stuff. We don't need kind of winter coats, things like that. It never gets cold here. It's, you know, it's always 90 degrees every day, just basically, unless there's a typhoon, which we just had a typhoon. Our tropical storm, we had flooding, and there was a bunch of people killed in the Philippines, even here near me, but we live in a place that doesn't flood. By the grace of God, it's a 100-year flood plain where I'm at. Praise the living God, but there are other areas where lots of flooding. I have a brother-in-law, it's a policeman, and they're delivering these relief packages. He's doing that now on Christmas. He's out. He was here tonight, and he had to leave. He's going to be out all starting at 4 o'clock in the morning. They'll be going to the relief centers and delivering food and water and stuff from the government. So they take, you know, it's just the policemen are rotating. You know, there's some other ones did it today, and he'll do it tomorrow. But anyhow, praise the living God. And that's your prayers for my brother-in-law, who's a policeman. You know, I wanted to mention that, too, while I'm rambling here. You know, I was just thinking about this last night. And I was talking to, as a matter of fact, I was talking to this sister, the one that the Lord gave me the word when we prayed about this list. Each of us to do a list. So anyway, this brother-in-law of mine, he wasn't my brother-in-law yet, because it's my sister-in-law's husband. At the time, that was my sister-in-law's fiance. And he was already a policeman at that time, you know. But he got dengue fever before Joshua did, maybe a year or two, maybe 2010, I think he got dengue fever. Might have been 2011. But for him, it went to his liver. There's like four different types of dengue fever. It can go to four different places. It's like kidneys, liver, heart, and maybe brain. I don't know. It's one of the places. I can't remember. But the heart one is the one that's almost 100% fatal. Or it is 100% fatal, I think. That's what Joshua had. He had the one that goes to your heart. But anyhow, just before that, and I didn't know anything about dengue fever. I didn't know that it was that deadly. I thought, well, you know, it's just like the measles. I thought it was make you sick, but I didn't know it could kill you. I mean, I didn't know anything about it. I've heard of it all my life. Yeah, dengue fever. So anyhow, I went there, and thank goodness I didn't know that it was so deadly that it almost kills like almost everybody that gets it. So especially in the Philippines, they don't have any hardly medicine. You know, he was in a hospital. He was in a room with four different people, and there was mosquitoes all in the room, which passed dengue fever. And you know, it's just the hospital is you don't even want to see it. You don't want to be here if you're sick. I'll put it that way. Even in the best hospitals in the Philippines, maybe in Manila, there might be International Standard Hospital. Maybe. Anyhow, so I prayed about it. And see, my sister-in-law had said, hey, he's going to die. And he thinks he's going to die. I believe he's going to die. Can you come pray with him? Because he wasn't a Christian. So I was like, all right. But I was thinking to myself, well, yeah, you know. I didn't know anything about dengue. I didn't use the Google. I didn't look it up. And I was just like, luckily, I mean, thank the Lord I didn't look it up because maybe, you know, because I was just, it was good that I didn't know any better, that it was so serious. For me, it was just like, yeah, right, yeah. I'll go over there and see him, pray with him. He's just being a crybaby or whatever. I mean, I don't know what I was thinking, but whatever, you know. So I go over there and pray with him, and then the Lord spoke to me and said, you know, the Lord spoke to me the word that you shall live and not die and declare the works of the Lord. And that was Isaiah 42 or 43. And, you know, and I told my sister-in-law that she had a Bible there. They were there reading the Bible and praying when I got there because, I mean, they really thought he was going to die. But like I said, I didn't take it seriously. Luckily, because I mean, I spoke that word and all the people were there and they're, you know, the doctors and all that didn't think, you know, I was going to die. But I was just like, yeah, right. But as I say, if I'd have known, of course, I don't know. But if I'd have known that they had all said he was going to die, maybe I wouldn't have had such good faith. I had childlike faith. I was just ignorant, you know. I went in there, the Lord gave me the word and I spoke it and it wasn't a big deal to me because that's what the Lord said. But for them, I think nobody believed me. Nobody believed me. But I believe he did because I prayed for him to get saved and all that. You know, he got saved that day. I just saw him tonight, and he's still a Christian. And of course, I see him at least two or three times a year, whatever, holidays or something, at least. Anyway, so he started getting better, and he lived, and he's healthy. He's still a policeman. You know, they have physical fitness tests they have to take every year, every 6 months or whatever, and here in the Philippines, he's able to do all that. So praise God. Praise God. I mean, he was healed. But that's what I was talking to the sister about. I was talking to a brother about this too. There's a dear brother, and I don't know if he wants me to say his name, who's been on the videos with me, and he's got a girlfriend, and then she had been taking Tylenol for a neck pain and taking too much. I mean, she didn't mean to. It built up in her liver and caused toxicity, and her whole body's shutting down. And I was talking to him. That's where this conversation started with that brother I talked to on Facebook yesterday, too. And, I haven't heard the update from him, but they were saying that she's not going to make it. And she's 59 years old. And her name is Tasha. I want you guys to pray for her. And so we were talking about how the Lord is sovereign. This brother and I, and then I was talking to the sister also, and saying that, you know, God is sovereign. You know, and so like when Joshua was sick, which I don't think I ever made videos about it. Well, it's been long enough now I'm making mention about it, but I don't think I've ever mentioned videos because before I wasn't able to talk about it. But by the grace of God, I talk about it some, a little bit. But the thing is, I've got my father-in-law who's a hardcore Baptist up until 2012, till when Joshua died. And he had never heard the Lord speaking to anybody, you know, things like that, you know. And so when Joshua was sick, my father-in-law had fervently prayed that that he could be the one to have dengue fever and that Joshua wouldn't be sick. You know, he said, you know, trying to make a deal with the Lord, you know, Lord, let me be the one that's sick. I'm already old, and then he's just a kid. Let him live. And the Lord spoke to him and said, why are you praying your own will? Why don't you pray my will for a change? That's what the Lord spoke it to him in it was like a disciplinary way, you know. And then when I prayed, the Lord spoke to me in a disciplinary way. And he gave me the text from Job where Satan wanted to kill, you know, was going to, hey, if you let the second time, Satan came to God about Job. He said, let me make him sick and all this. He'll curse you to your face. And God said, you can do anything to him, but you can't take his life. You cannot take his life. The Lord gave me that text when I was praying for Joshua. And then he gave me the text from, it says that Jesus said a sparrow can't fall to the ground without your father's permit, without God's permission. And aren't you worth more than many sparrows, O ye of little faith? It's in the Sermon on the Mount, Matthew chapter 6, 7, and 8. 5, 6, and 7. And so the Lord gave me that text too. And the Lord just told me, look, I have sovereignty over who lives and who dies. Everyone has a time. To everything, as the Bible says in Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verse 10, to everything there is a season, and there's nothing new under the sun. To everything there is a season, to a time to live and a time to die. And so God, we all have a day that we're going to die. Unless we're raptured, all of us have a day that we are going to die. And God knows that day, and by the grace of God, we don't. Now, John Wesley, who started the Methodist Church, God told him the day he was going to die, and he wrote it in his journals, and he died that day. And that's the only person I know of who did that. I'm sure there's others. For whatever reason, God knew they could handle it, or for whatever reason, God would do it. God would tell individuals that he trusted with the information because they were great servants or whatever. I don't know. But so the Lord was telling me in a stern way, no. He told me, no, I will not turn from this. This is going to happen. No. He didn't tell me why, but he's not going to repent of it. As the Bible said, when God talked with Moses and then God repented of his plan, turned his decision of what he was going to do. After he conversed with Moses about destroying the children of Israel when they made a golden calf and all that. But the Lord told me no. He told me three or four times. I prayed about it and then waited a little while, prayed again. But it was like a 2 or 3 day period. The Lord kept telling me no. Then I told my father-in-law, I told my father-in-law what the Lord said. And I was shocked when he said, well, the Lord spoke to me too and said, why do you keep praying my will or your will? Why don't you pray my will? That shocked me. So I said, well, I guess it's definitely 100% going to happen, and that's it. There's just no ways about it. But then I have a sister-in-law also, another sister-in-law who heard from the Lord too, and the Lord told her the same thing, that no, he's not going to, this is his time. For whatever reason, brothers and sisters, we don't know. And so that's what I told my wife's family at that time. I said, well, he could have grown up and not been a Christian. We don't know that. I mean, maybe that's what it is. I was trying to think of a good way to think about it. He's only 5 years old, so we know he went to heaven. But, maybe he'd grown up and been a bad person and not been a Christian and then not have been going to heaven. So we just don't know, brothers and sisters, any of these things. Just like that sister, we don't know what the reason is that she's going to this organ failure. But we can believe until she leaves this world, until God tells us, unless the Lord tells you differently, we believe that everybody's going to be healed. Unless the Lord tells me different, I believe for everybody I ever pray with to be healed, unless the Lord says, no, my grace is sufficient for thee, as he told Paul. But other than that, unless God specifically says, no, I'm not going to heal you for a specific reason or none of your business reason, I believe God heals. He always does, brothers and sisters. He always does. But we do have a time when we're supposed to leave this earth. That is also a fact. That is also a fact. As I just explained, an actual situation where I saw that, even though I already knew that, but I saw it play out in my own life. Anyway, brothers and sisters, as you see, I'm always all over the place. You know how it is. I love you guys. I appreciate you guys. I wanted to, 1 year I had my son and my wife with me in a video. Maybe I'll ask them to, we'll try to do it. We've been so busy with everything. I know my wife's worn out from all the stuff with the orphanages and everything. And, with her family here. But I'll try to get them together and make a little video. And you can see my children and say Merry Christmas and all that. Happy New Year, etc. So we'll be seeing you guys. I might try to get on here and make a lot of videos. It's in my spirit to make a bunch of videos. God bless y'all. I love y'all. Merry Christmas. Happy New Year. In the world's count of it, as I said. The whole world counts that day. You can pick any day and say Jesus was born that day. We don't know. You can pick any day and say it's a new year, whatever, That's the calendar that everybody uses. There you go, brothers and sisters. God bless you all.